Halo, and thank you for stopping, looking, and listening to our divine appointment here today. I'm Sandra on another episode of Calling All Angels Hotline. That's right, right here, right now, we're live at 5 calling on you from the number one access station in the nation. And guess what? I'm here today with a local celebrity, and that is Paint with Joe!
Hi, Sandra.
I'm so excited, and so glad that you're here today.
I'm excited to be here.
Oh, I can tell you came early, and we were talking and talking and talking, and I said, Joe, we have to save some of this information for our audience today. I know they're all out there watching. Mm-hmm. They knew that you were going to be on today, didn't they?
I hope so.
Well, we're going to have a lot of fun here today.
We sure are.
I'm going to try to get into the inside and out with all of the questions.
Okay.
Are you ready for that, Joe?
Okay.
Good. I'm glad you're flexible.
Flexible. Very flexible. Yeah.
I saw that with the paintbrush in the mm-hmm. opening. That was very clever.
Yes. Yes.
You did a nice job with that opening, Joe.
Well, now we'll have to give Northman credit for that.
Well, yeah, okay. Angel we'll assistants out there. Everyone's here. Everyone's behind their camera and the audio. And guess what? This is a live show. Mm. Live call-in show here, Joe.
It's the first time.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
First time for me.
You know what the number is?
Oh.
Oh.
You'll tell them, won't
I you? Will. That live-in call-in number is 422-3902. We welcome you with your thoughts, comments, or questions here today, live with Paint with Joe, our local celebrity. He's going to talk. We're going to show pictures. We're going to, it's a fast, full hour here of edutainment.
Okay.
All right. Well, I am so honored to be in your presence because you started doing your work here at Access Station when? In about... What
2002.
Year was it? 2002. 2002.
Yeah. We started, the show debuted March 29th. Yeah.
And that was in the old station, right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
The old library, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. March. Well, wasn't that your wife's birthday or something,
yeah,
Joe?
Yeah, the show debuted on her birthday. Yeah, that was the first show.
Well, now, if I get a little too personal, you can just say, wait a minute, Sandra, but tell us how that happened.
I don't know. I really don't know.
It was what do you just, mean you don't just, know, Joe?
I didn't have any control over the air date.
Oh, no control over the air date.
No.
Yeah.
We just produced the show, and it was aired on March 29th.
Well, but wait a minute. Let's back up. I need to get to the heart and the soul of how this all happened. What, were you a child when you start doing this, Joe, or what?
Oh, no. I started about 7 years ago.
Me too, yep. Joe.
Yeah.
7 years. Boy, every 7 years there's a cycle, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
7 years. So what happened? Tell us. We want to know.
Well, I never painted before in my life, and never only to paint the house, like everyone has
like
to do.
Like the trim and the woodwork and the outside or the inside?
Well, both.
Okay.
Both at times.
And the garage?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got to do that.
Yeah.
You got to do the garage if you're going to do that.
The driveway, you know?
Not the driveway.
No. Well, some people paint their driveways with tar and all that, you know.
No, that's only if you have asphalt.
Okay.
Yeah. I usually have gravel.
Gravel.
Then I mow it.
Okay. Well, okay, so what is that? What is that stuff that's on the walls? Not plywood, but.
Oh, drywall?
Drywall. Mm-hmm. Do you paint drywall?
Oh, yeah. You can do that. Yeah.
Then. You painted
back
then.
Oh, not then. When I'm painting a house, that's what walls are generally
set
made
me
of.
Straight, that, Joe. I'm here to learn, just like everyone else out there.
Okay.
Okay. So you paint it dry. You paint it inside and out, and then what?
Well, I started watching Bob Ross on TV. Bob Ross, if your viewers don't know, is the host of the Joy of Painting TV series. It's been on for PBS for 20 years. And Bob just mesmerizes people with his voice and also with the painting. So I started watching, and he kept saying, you can do this, you can do this. And I kept saying, no, I can't. Well, one time I tried it. My wife kind of embarrassed me a little bit. She says, why don't you go buy the stuff you need and try it? So I did that, and lo and behold, here I am teaching people how to do it now. So
it was a heart-to-heart connection with
kinda.
Bob.
Yeah, it was.
I think I saw him a few times, and I agree. His voice is rather attractive. Mm-hmm. But so is yours, and that's what I'm really admiring about you.
Well, I really enjoy this. I enjoy the teaching. I enjoy the show. The whole crew enjoys putting it on. It's just kind of lights up our Mondays when we come down to tape. So
now, Jill, I'll save that. Do you still have a learning curve while you're doing this, while you're teaching? Is there still a learning curve for you while you're teaching?
Oh yeah, I try to learn. Yeah, every class I teach, I learn something. Yeah, because my students have it, will give me input as well. And so when my students are having trouble, and I get to help them, you know, that's a learning curve for me. So I learn something every time I paint.
Let me remind our viewers out there, that number is 422-3902. This is a Live at 5 call-in, and we're only here till 6 p.m. tonight. I'm Sandra, here with the one, the only, Joe. Paint with Joe Knight here, and he's a celebrity of Fort Wayne. So don't hold back. Pick up that phone, dial that number, and call in. Right, Joe?
Right.
You're ready for it.
Ready.
See, and you're not painting today.
That's right.
We wanted
That's
to right. give you the top shelf treatment here today. We wanted your full attention so okay. you can interact with everyone.
Okay. That would be fine.
Joe, what if, you know, is this a paint by number method?
No, it isn't.
No?
This particular painting right here, the waterfall, is done on a black canvas. We paint the canvas black in the center here. And then no numbers. We just put the trees in with a paintbrush and put the waterfall in with a paintbrush. And no numbers at all.
When I was a child, I used to love to paint by numbers. And I think it was oil paint.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of paint is this?
This is oil.
Oh, it is?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and
it's
that's
oil
on
paint.
Canvas.
On canvas,
now,
yes.
Well, there's no water in it, right?
No, there's no water with oil. Oil
okay.
and water doesn't mix.
Oh, that's yeah. right.
Yeah.
Well, that makes sense, Joe.
Yeah, yeah. We have to use thinner if we want to thin our paint.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, how does that circle get put around there? I mean...
Well, what I do is I take a piece of contact paper.
Okay.
You know, the type of contact paper you'd buy in a supermarket and put on a shelf. It's got a sticky side, and I just cut the oval.
Like that I put in my utensil drawers or my linen
sure.
drawers. Okay.
Absolutely. And then I cut the oval out of it, and I apply it to the canvas. And then we paint on the inside. On
it
the
looks
oval.
Like a halo, Joe.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like the halos that the angels wear.
And then when we're all finished, we just pull the contact paper off the painting. And now this gold around the outside, that's a dry brush. We just take a dry brush and we use some of the background color, and we just dry brush that on. And
that's
it kind
exquisite.
Of, if I wouldn't have dry brushed that would have been white, pure white, the canvas. So that kind of makes it stand out.
Exquisite.
Mm-hmm.
Exquisite.
Thank you.
Okay, now let's go back to, because I'm trying to help people out there with the story of you, Joe,
okay.
since 2002. How many shows have you done here at the Access Station?
I think we've got real close to 90 shows now. 90 shows.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we've been on, in 2002, I won the Philo T. Farnsworth Video Festival Award in first place.
I'm glad you said that, even though I was going to tell everybody, first place.
Well, I love to tell people about the awards.
Oh, yeah.
And then in 2003, we won the Hometown Video Festival. And for some of your viewers, if they don't know, that's a nationwide festival.
It is.
So
it is.
Won first place there, and I got to fly to Tacoma, Washington to pick up my receipt or my reward.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so cool. Mm. Yeah, so cool. I really enjoyed that.
When was that one? Last
that
year?
That was 2003. Yep.
That's amazing.
Yep.
Now, all of your work, all of your shows are done right here in the studio.
Correct.
Yeah,
yes.
You don't do the. That's okay.
We're planning on doing some remotes, maybe out Fryman Square, places like
that.
Oh, that outside.
Would be nice.
Yeah,
we'd
like
nice.
To do that. I just wanted to get the show going first, get the crew together. We've got a wonderful crew. They just do a super job.
Supreme
and,
team.
And I just wanted to have them all together and have them online. Then we'll start going out and doing different things because the atmospheres are different outside. In the studio, we pretty much set up the same way each time and it gets to be easy. But when you go outside, then you're putting a lot of different things into the production. So we'll do that, but we'll take our time.
Now, I know you didn't know what to expect when you came here today, Joe.
Mm-hmm.
And I really appreciate that you brought some of your work with you on B-roll. Would you mind if we showed a little bit of that
today? That would be fine.
Let's ask Norm, our director out there, would you mind putting one of those clips that Joe brought with him today? And let's show some of our audience some in process.
Today I'm using the 1-inch brush. And I'm just going to come up here and start putting in some crimson in my sky. I'm going to use a little bit of phthalo blue too, but I want to use the crimson first, because the phthalo blue and the crimson make a beautiful purple sky, and that's what I'm after today. Now, when you put the liquid white on your canvas, now I'm going to go into phthalo blue. I want to put a little bit of that in here. When you put your contact paper and your liquid white on your canvas, you want to make sure that you pull in from the sides, like this way, because if you pull in out this way, chances are you might just lift the contact paper. Now, it's not a real bad thing if that happens. It just means that some of the color might bleed through the outside of the canvas when you're done. So we're going to put some water in this painting. As you know, I like water. And wherever we don't want water, we'll just go all the way across today. Sometimes I leave a little light area in the center, but today I think we'll just go clear across. Now, if you have some light and dark spots in your water, that's okay. As you see, I have some crimson color in my water, and that's okay too. I want that in there, because if it's still water, it's going to reflect the sky color, and the sky color is definitely crimson and blue. There we go. Now we have a sky and we have water. So now I'm going to blend my sky. I'm going to start here in the lighter area first, and I'm just going to blend outward, and I'm going to soften this sky. You can soften this sky to any degree of softness that you want, but I would suggest that if you have a real nice spot in your sky and you like it, don't blend it very much, because if you do and soften it enough, it'll just go away and leave you. It'll say goodbye, and then you might not be too happy. Of course, then that's one of those happy accidents, so you can just fix it. So don't ever worry. Now you see how that's blended? I'm going to take long horizontal strokes clear across the sky and then down across the water. When you're using these ovals, you got a lot less surface to paint on too. And sometimes you can use a smaller brush. Sometimes you can even use less paint.
I love it. I love the happy accidents in there. And I saw where you had the halo. I'm going to call it halo because that's what I remember. Okay. The halo contact on there, and then it wasn't allowing any of the paint to go on the sides.
Correct.
Now, you do landscapes and florals, and what this one was with the water.
Yeah, that would be a landscape.
Okay.
Yes, And then I do seascapes, which are ocean scenes.
Oh.
With or without palm trees.
Oh.
And then I do wildlife.
And sandy beaches, too?
Sandy beaches. Yeah, we do Florida seascapes and Hawaii seascapes and all kinds of different seascapes.
Wow. Yeah. And here's one of the...
That's an example. The dolphin is an example of our wildlife. I'm a certified wildlife instructor with the Bob Ross Company. And that's a very, very popular dolphin. It's two parts, though. The first part is acrylic, which dries very fast. And then we overpaint it with oil. So the color on there is oil paint. That takes a couple of weeks to dry. Yeah, it takes a while to dry, but the acrylic underneath is very quick drying paint.
Now, see, that's what I remember from my childhood. I think it had to be the acrylic, because it took weeks and weeks and weeks to dry. And I thought, sometimes my mother would make sure that, to tell me, put that somewhere where it's not going to get touched.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the oils are very long drying. I had brought a painting home from one of my classes at Michael's, and I put it in a spare bedroom, and I just knew nobody would get in there.
Yeah.
Well, one of our cats
I was just
in there.
Thinking, what about cats? Do you have cats?
We just cleaned the carpet, and she came out with phthalo blue footprints all over the
carpets. Did you keep them? Did you keep the footprints on the carpet?
No, we cleaned them
up. Oh, did you? Yeah. That'd be a good design.
That wasn't a very happy accident, believe me.
No.
So we took care of that, but still got the cat. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So let's go back to Lois. I admire her for really encouraging.
She puts up with a lot.
Does she put up with a lot? Yeah. But she encouraged you to go to the Bob Ross. Where is that? How did you do that?
Well, there's only three places in the country you can go. Portland, Oregon is one place. New Smyrna Beach, Florida, which is where I go, just because it's south of Daytona and it's beautiful down there. Or Chantilly, Virginia. Those are the only three places that you can go to be certified.
And how long did it take? It
takes 3 weeks for each certification.
You're kidding.
No, 3 weeks. It takes three weeks for each certification.
Oh, okay.
1 week each time you go. You have to go to level one, level two, and level three. So.
And now you're above divine order.
Oh, well, I'm above level three, let's put it that
way.
Yeah. So I've earned my
wings.
I've earned my wings, so to speak, and now I'm kind of flying on my own. But all of my students do fantastic. Their first time. You don't have to have ever touched a paintbrush before to do this. It's very, 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 very easy to learn. It's oil's a very forgiving painting style, especially the wet-on-wet technique that we use.
It looks like it can be a very healing experience.
It's very
well.
Peaceful.
Yeah.
Yeah. When you paint a tree, you know, people ask me, well, how do you know what to paint? Well, go outside and look. You got trees out in your backyard, just look at the tree and put it on canvas, you know. And after a few brush strokes and you learn how to use the equipment and you just use your mind, you let your mind wander. Sometimes when I'm traveling, I'll take pictures. I love to do that. And then I might take a mountain out of one picture, I might take a tree out of another one, and a cabin out of another one, put them all together and make a painting out of it. So, and it's very peaceful. Sometimes I just, when I'm doing my demos, I just paint and immerse myself in that particular location, wherever it might be in the world. So it's fun.
And we know right where you are too, Joe, when you're painting.
Yeah.
You're at a peaceful place.
Yep.
Tell us about your students. How many students have you had?
I've been teaching since 1998, and I would say probably over 500 students.
Oh, yeah. That's a lot. And so how long do they last? I mean, how long do you teach them?
Well, sometimes they come for one class. Sometimes they come for more than one. It just depends. Sometimes you can pick up enough information to get yourself started after one class. But golly, sometimes I had my first student came for 15 weeks in a row. We painted together. So she got quite good, and then she got busy with other things, of course, and I haven't seen her for a few months, but anyway, it doesn't, usually you come for one class, and you get a completed painting, you go home with a completed painting of your own, and then you decide for yourself if you need more classes, but you can have as many as you want.
Now, I understand some of our local merchants are supporting you in what you're doing, with supplies and with some assistance here in the area, and that you may be offering some of your teachings at different locales here in the area.
Yeah, I do teach at Michael's Arts and Crafts Store out at Jefferson Point.
Okay.
And they're providing the supplies for my show. They're helping me out there. And then Kinko's is...
That's awesome.
They produce the 2x3 foot posters that we use on the show. And the poster, there's one poster at Michael's hanging up, and then I take one with me whenever I do a demonstration.
Do you ever get paint on your face?
Sure.
Do you?
Sure.
That's a strange question, but I was wondering, you know, because I remember the Three Stooges?
Mm-hmm.
I used to watch them when I was a kid, and I was thinking, you know, they'd get into all kind of stuff, and no matter what it was, paint was one thing that they managed to get all over them.
I was doing a demo once out at Michael's, and this little guy, I don't know how old he was, probably 10 or 11 years old, and he was watching me, and his dad was behind him. And I told him, I said, I'm going to put in my horizon line. Will you make sure it's straight for me? And he says, oh, yeah. Well, when I got done with the painting, I stood back and I looked at it. It was about an inch and a half off on one side, and both of them were laughing.
Uh-huh.
And I said, yeah, that's pretty funny, isn't it? So I just went up and fixed it. And he says, no, we weren't laughing at that. We were laughing at your blue nose. So I had blue paint on the end of my nose, but.
Did you have to get real close to the picture when you first started?
Well, when you're first starting, you're within a foot and a half from your canvas. Yeah.
Yeah.
What you have to do is while you're painting, you have to step back away from it and look at it so that you can get the whole perspective. You can get the whole painting. A lot of times, if you're just doing a mountain, you're real close to it and all you're seeing is just your peaks. But if you get back away from it, then you can see the whole mountain. So that's what we do in class. We get back 5 to 50 feet.
Now, what is your favorite age group that you like to teach?
I like to work with the younger people.
Like what age?
I teach 8 and up, so there's no upper limit.
Oh no!
I have a student right now, a floral student. She's 72. So, yeah.
72.
Yeah, and she does really good. And I had an 11-year-old in class. We did the baby harp seal at Michael's last Sunday, and it was her first time, and she just did beautiful. So,
I bet you learn something from them too, don't you?
Oh yeah, absolutely. The younger people don't have the "I can't do it" attitude like I did.
No, their altitude is high.
They're just ready to go for anything, and that's just remarkable. It's marvelous, really. Mm-hmm. I really enjoy teaching them.
It's a real sacred place for them too at that age. It gives them a nice foundation to be still and see what can come from their inside through them. It's a real nice age. Yeah. 8's nice age, too. Yeah. They're all good. They're all good, and they're a lot of fun.
Yeah, they are fun. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I enjoy teaching them.
Now, you brought some more clips with you, didn't you?
Yes, today? I did. Yes.
I want to see more. How about like a waterfall?
Yeah, I think there's a clip of a waterfall.
I mean, because I'm sitting here, and I'm seeing the beauty of this waterfall. Before we go into that, what color is that right in the center, right where the I'm going to say, in my descriptive, in the brightest area, in the center of that,
right here is titanium white. There's Indian yellow and yellow ochre behind it, and then titanium white right in the center for the light spot. Mm-hmm.
I think that would be quite interesting to try and explain that to somebody who would have a sight impaired, who would be sight impaired. Try to explain the colors to them. You know, how do they create when they, or do they know?
I did have a student the other day, as a matter of fact, that I guess you could call it sight impaired. He was colorblind. He couldn't tell the difference between, he could see dark and light, but he couldn't tell the difference between the phthalo blue and the Van Dyke brown, although sometimes that's kind of hard for me, so I put them at the same place all the time on the palette, because they're close, unless until you pull them out, it's kind of hard to tell. But he did real well in the painting. He would just ask, what color is this? And I said, well, that's the Van Dyke and that's the dark sienna, not just mix them together. So he did, and he did a fine job.
You did a fine job, I'm sure, in directing him and acquainting him with colors that he probably had no idea other than the basic, red, blue, yellow, green, white, black, or whatever. And the reason why I brought that to mind because of, I was just thinking about my website, the Access website. It was recently birthed by two men who are sight impaired.
Wow.
And I remember in directing them to color, the purples or blues. I'm just going to be basic with, because I don't know. I'm learning here today. And I'm trying to, direct into making all these colors the right way, and it was truly an experience for me and for them to learn that. But go to the website, it's unreal to see how they, I didn't have a clue how the website could even begin, and I click on that little mouse and there it is, purple and gold and all kind of streaming stuff going on. But that's what led me to that, because I think, boy, that would be so interesting to see someone like that paint. And I'm sure, because, these guys have drive that they can do anything.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure it's happened. I'm sure there have been sight impaired people that paint. I don't know of anybody right now, but I just feel that it has happened before.
I bet you could teach them, too.
Oh, probably, yeah. Anybody can learn. Anybody can be taught, as long as they want to be. That's
as
the
long
biggest
as they
thing.
Want. That's yeah. the truth.
If you desire to learn, you'll learn.
Mm-hmm. And whether you're right-handed or left,
doesn't
I'm
make
sure.
any difference. Nope, no difference at all. Mm-hmm. You just, if you're left-handed, you use the left hand, and if you're right-handed, you use your right hand. So I don't have very many left-handed students, but when I do, it's really a treat because they're doing it the way I do it, and the right-handed people are saying, gee whiz, did I do it right? So, yeah.
You know, there's people out there that do things with their feet, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If there's a will, there's a way.
That's right.
If there's a will, there's a way. And I want to see that waterfall. Take it away, Norm. I can't wait.
Oh, that misty area back there. Another big tree over here. And lots of times I like to leave areas in between my trees. Like right here, you can see back, way back, back in here. Let's make another big tree right here. We're gonna start getting bigger over to this side. These trees got more sun, more food, and they just grew real big. Here's one right here. By golly, he went clear off the top of that, clear out of the canvas. Well, not really, because you'll see what happens at the end of the show when I take this contact paper off. See? There we go. Over here. Way over on this side now. A nice, big, tall tree. Now you can put the whole trunk in if you want, just like that. But reload your brush when you do that, because each time you take paint off your brush, you have to reload. All right, now it's time to do some reflecting. So I'm going to reflect these trees into the lake. I'm going to start right here in the center, touch and pull down, straight down. Over here, touch, pull down, and then pull across. Lightly, easy, no pressure pulling across. And that'll give these trees a wavy line. Pull across as many times as you need, but just be careful when you pull across. Now, I see some more trees right here. Here's one. And there's a lot of land down here. A lot of land. Wow. Bunch of land down here. Look at that. I see the same thing over here. I bet maybe you're already seeing what I'm seeing. But we'll keep going here. Going to be a little surprise in this painting for you. And I bet you've already figured out what that's going to be. Going to reflect these in. Pull across. It's important to pull straight down and pull across. Okay, let's see. Back to my filbert brush. I'll show you how to do a pine tree with a filbert brush. I'm going to go up into...
I want to go there.
Yeah, that's a nice place.
It takes my breath away.
Yes, thank you. You could do that too.
I think I can.
I know you can.
You make it look so easy, Joe.
I know, I've been told that. You make it so easy on the TV show, but you know, all you need to do is really learn how to use the tools and then practice. I've been practicing for 7 years. Every time I do a painting, I practice.
That's a good habit, Joe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's a real good habit. Yeah.
And sometimes I paint paintings and I don't even paint anything. I just do trees, or I just do clouds, or I just do waterfalls, or I just do cabins or barns or whatever, whatever I want to work with. I don't worry about completing a painting. You know, just don't worry about anything when you're painting. You just put whatever you think of on canvas. And it works. It works. Mm. It'll all come together. When it's ready, it'll all come together.
How many paintings do you have, Joe?
Oh, my. I would say I've painted thousands of paintings. Probably 3,000 or 4,000 paintings. Yeah.
Yeah. And they're all in your house now.
A lot more, yes.
And good, Lois. Yeah. And now Lois is saying,
in stacks.
He really did follow my direction.
Yeah, sure did.
Wow.
And I'm happy for that too, because I just enjoy doing it so much. Just wanna let everybody know they can do it. Everybody needs to know you can paint like this if you want to.
So. I'm still enjoying the peace and the calm that I got from watching that. Mm-hmm. Because I thought to myself, if that paintbrush was in my right hand, what would I do? I mean, I used to be a perfectionist, Joe. I'm not mm-hmm. any longer, but I would, you know, as you were going back into the trees and doing that line, you know, and then how that shadow just appeared. I'm sure there was so much more of a foundation that you had in there with colors to create that finished product.
You mean when I was doing the water, the reflections?
Yeah, when you were doing the reflections.
Actually, it's just the liquid white that we put on the canvas before we start. Mm-hmm. That's underneath as a base, mm-hmm. and that moistens the canvas. And all I was doing was just pulling that dark color down into it, pulling it across. And that's what causes that to blend like that. It's the fact that it's wet on wet. That's what we call this. It's wet underneath, and the paint that we put on is wet. And it blends so beautifully that way.
The other day I saw, I digress all the time.
Sure.
This is where we're going, Joe. The other day I opened up a magazine, and it was the first of a full spread. Mm-hmm. And on there was the water, okay? It mm-hmm. was the water. And there was a drop of water just about ready to touch that water surface. And you know how it trickles mm-hmm. out?
Yeah.
What was amazing was on that drop of water was a halo.
Oh,
but I think of the water on the waterfall mm-hmm. and how it looks so still, you know, because you did that smoothing effect and you had mm-hmm. all that shadowing and all the colors and almost could see the fish in there, Joe.
Yeah. Well, you'll get to see a waterfall in the next segment that Nora
yeah.
brings.
Yeah.
I brought another one too.
I have a question for you first. What did you like to do as a child? I mean, what did you play with as a child?
Well, now you're taking me way back.
Well, the reason why
Erector sets.
And G.I. Joes?
Not so much G.I. Joes. Well, yeah, we used to shoot army men, little plastic army men with rubber bands. And our family, we used to beat each other up with rolled up newspapers. That was fun. Nobody ever got hurt, but, well, maybe.
Well, you know, as I mentioned earlier, you kind of took me back to the childhood, and I was thinking about the young adults that you inspire with your teaching and the paint by number, and, you know, what did I really do as a child that I'm doing today? Because they say, you know, I've heard this mentioned, that whatever you're doing when you're a child in your playtime, you may consider taking as a career, and or sometimes people change careers like mm-hmm. every 7 years or something. Mm-hmm. What were you doing 7 years ago, Joe?
7 years ago, I was just pushing buttons on a machine, making stuff. So
what kind
just
of
running
machine?
A machine. A Class B turret lathe is what I was working with. Just machining metal. Yeah. And I decided I don't want to do this anymore. So
it's pretty cold, wasn't it?
Yeah. So I decided to develop a teaching career. Yeah.
Now, did you ever teach anything before in your life?
No. Uh-uh. No.
That's amazing. Yes. No wonder you're a celebrity, for heaven's sakes.
Well, I like it.
Well,
yes.
It's okay to like it, Joe. It's okay to have fun.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay to be full of life. And that's what you are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit more about this one.
Okay.
This one reminds me of the zoo. Okay. Our Fort Wayne Zoo.
Okay.
When you go to the zoo, they have these shows, you know, and they have the mammals, and they tell a story in their behaviors and their different things. Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit more about this one.
Well, he's going down there to get something to eat.
Yeah.
Amongst the coral, string coral, and I painted another dolphin at home just playing around one day, and I put a scuba diver in. And then I did another one with a shark in there and some fishes, some real small fish. So I would imagine he's having fun swimming down there, diving down, getting whatever he can get.
Did you ever think about swimming with the dolphins?
Well, my daughter, we're digressing again here, Joe. My daughter wants to do that, but I suppose if I ever got the chance, I might do it. But it really doesn't excite me to do that.
Not yet.
Not yet.
Maybe in the next 7 years.
Maybe in the next 7 years.
And what other animals have you painted?
Oh, lions, tigers, jaguars,
and bears.
grizzly bears, yeah, elephants, giraffes. Yeah. Squirrels.
You know, that's pretty popular right now. Mm-hmm. They call them some of those totem animals. Did you know that?
No,
yes,
I didn't know that.
That's pretty popular. Yes, pretty popular to find out what your totem animal is.
Yeah, you can see a lot of my wildlife if you go on my website, paintwithjoe.com.
Paintwithjoe.com.
Yeah.
I'm going to go there, Joe.
Okay.
I haven't been there yet. I have to take 20 seconds and remind everyone out there who's watching the show today, I know it's your supper hour, and I'm Sandra here today, and I'm talking with a celebrity, Calling All Angels here, live at 5. That number is 422-3902. We'd love to hear from you. That's right, right here, right now. Right, Joe?
Right.
Yeah. Right. So I just didn't want them thinking that we were ignoring them. We're sitting here having so much fun. What were we talking about, Joe?
Animals.
We were talking about the wildlife and jaguars. You paint jaguars,
mm-hmm.
too?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah, there's an example of that on the front page of the website. Front page of the website. So.
Arvel Bird told me last week that my totem animal was a jaguar.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Wow.
He said it's very popular, very exciting. Do children like to do animals, or do they like to paint?
Well, I haven't had any children yet do the animals, because the only three animals that I have, the wildlife, would be the dolphin, the panda, and the harp seal. Those are the only 3-hour classes I have. All the other wildlife are so intense that it requires all day. So not many people...
Wow.
Can do the all-day class, but they're really popular. People love to look at them, so that makes me happy.
Have you ever seen that movie, What Dreams May Come?
I don't think
with
I have.
Robin Williams,
mm-hmm.
and the paintings throughout that movie. If you get a chance, watch that movie. It's
okay.
Very colorful, very alive. I just thought of it because there's so many vivid purples and blues, and it's very interesting.
Okay,
but. Okay, Joe.
Okay.
We'll go back to your clip that you were gonna show us another clip, right?
Yes, I believe there's another clip.
And they
there.
Were patiently waiting to show everyone. I just enjoy talking with you.
Oh, I do too. I enjoy talking with you as well.
Well, let's go and see.
Okay. If we don't do that, they'll look like they're standing on top. And these rocks have been out here for years. We'll put another little bush over here real quick. See how easy it is to put a bush in if you want? And if you want to highlight your trees, you can do that too. Just touch. Highlight them the same way that you did when you put them in. You can highlight all of them or just a few. Isn't that pretty? We've got a pretty day, don't we? It's a pretty day here. Of course, we're in a studio right now, but boy, it sure is nice outside. I hope it's nice where you are too. Okay, now I'm going to lay my palette down and I'm going to go up here and take the paper off and we'll see what we have. Wow, isn't that nice? So we got one more thing to do here. I thank you for watching, and sure hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to take my fan brush and just take this tree right here. Out of the etch. And maybe we'll do that over here. Thanks for watching, and until next time, happy painting.
Happy painting.
Yes.
Joe, that is so beautiful. Why do you have those trees outside of there?
Oh, that's just something that's kind of fun to do. Rather than have them confined in the oval, just let them poke out. That's kind of fun.
Just wondering.
Just for effect.
Just wondering.
Yeah, yeah.
Cause
it's kind of
effect.
Fun to do that.
You really put a lot of detail in that last print. Did that take 28 minutes to paint, or did you pre-paint that before you came into the studio?
Oh, no. No, when we start the show, we start with a blank canvas with the liquid white on it. And then I paint the complete painting in 28 minutes. Yeah. Yeah.
Look at that. And I like how you see the ruffles there at the front of the picture with the rocks and the stones and the and the land.
And you have the splashies there, and then the splashies bring the little waves or ripples out into the water. Do you see that?
It could be a fish.
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, it could be a big old bass in there.
One time I was in Kansas City and I was visiting. I was visiting in Kansas City and I had the wonderful opportunity to experience a labyrinth. Do you know what a labyrinth is?
No, I don't.
It's something like a maze. It's like a maze that you sometimes would see with shrubbery or bushes. This one was painted on the ground. And it was specifically so you can walk through the different path to get to the center. It was a walking meditation labyrinth. And when I got to the center, Joe, I looked up to the sky, and in the clouds was an angel. Yeah. And so when I was looking at your picture out there, I was seeing that as a gentle reminder. You know how, see how you have the pinks in there? Well, there was some real, they were softer pinks in the angel that I saw. But it was just like that. And I looked up and I just got overwhelmed with that happy feeling that you talked about when you were painting that.
I was over in Hawaii several years back, and I teach over there. I typically try to go over there every year, but I didn't make it last year. But one morning I was sitting out on the beach at the ocean in the morning, and I was I had my easel and my paints and everything, and I was going to paint a sunrise. And the sun just came over the crater, and you know how there was pink in the sky, and the clouds were floating by. And if I'd have had a camera, I wished I'd have had my camera out there, but I didn't. But there was a cloud that was almost in the shape of a humpback whale. And just the outside tips of it were pink. It was just the sun was starting to rise over the crater, and it was just gorgeous. It was just beautiful. I wished I'd have had my camera because I'd have definitely taken a picture of that. And then the whales were in, and you could see them breaching out. It was neat. It was super.
Well, and if you think back in your childhood, well, I'm constantly taking us back to childhood.
Yes.
But, so often you look up to the sky and see the clouds, and you'd always find pictures in them, you know?
Yeah.
I know I would.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah, you can see Mickey Mouse and
whatever. And the trees.
Yeah, but I'll tell you, once you start painting, you look at the world in a whole new light. You just don't see things the same anymore. you'll drive by trees now and they're just trees. But once you start painting, they're not trees anymore. They're, wow, you know, you might take a picture of one to take it home and paint it because it's just different.
You used a word in that painting, reflection. Mm-hmm. It wasn't only the reflection of the water. See, when I look at that photograph of the picture and I see it all, whether it's on the picture or whether it's in these trees or mm-hmm. outside, I see those reflections as God. Mm-hmm. That's what God means to me. Mm-hmm. All the beauty, and I see it with a different eye, like you said.
He created it all.
yeah.
I can't imagine who could have done it but him, so it's there. It's there for everybody to enjoy.
And to appreciate.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I have this huge tree in my front yard. You should come and see it sometime. It's a pine tree, mm-hmm. and it's huge. And in fact, the branches, this is so cool, because the branches eloquently sway in front of my bay window mm-hmm. and serve as a drapery. I don't have to buy draperies for this house because it sways. But, you know, sometimes when I'm out there, and this may sound really strange, but I'll go over to that tree and I'll just hug that tree because I'm so thankful for it, you know.
Yeah,
but it has such life to it, and that's what you do through the paintings, mm-hmm. through you, onto the canvas.
Yeah.
You put the life right on there.
Well, that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about, putting your dreams on canvas. Everyone can do it. You just have to want to try. That's the first step. Just give yourself permission to put the brush in your hand. And once you do that, then you're on the road.
Give yourself permission.
Yep.
I strongly support that. I strongly support that. That's so true. You know, we give ourselves permission to do so many other things.
Oh yeah, sure.
You know.
You just gotta give yourself the chance. You just gotta try it one time. Mm. You'll be hooked. It's mesmerizing. It's a wonderful thing to do.
So now, what's next for you, Joe?
Well, I want to continue teaching, of course.
Yes.
And there's one more certification that I want to get, and that's portrait.
Ah.
Portrait certification.
Okay.
I don't get a lot of interest in that, but I think that will help me with pet portraits, which is what I'd like to do.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'd like to do pet portraits.
Oh, yeah.
So the combination of the portrait certification and the wildlife certification helps me bring that whole pet portrait thing together. So that's what I want to do next.
I think that would be a blessing to learn mm-hmm. the pets. Because, you know, I don't know, you know, my pets to me are like human beings.
Oh, yeah. Everyone's pet is, yeah.
Oh, that's... Yeah. This morning, my dog, Rich, he has a tendency to come into the bedroom. Now, I get up at 4 in the morning, so mm-hmm. he'll come and just sit by the bed with his instinct, knowing, Sandra, it's time to get up, you know. And sometimes he doesn't have to come in there, and we have that sense.
Mm-hmm.
And always knows when I'm coming home, no matter when it is, you know. And they are definitely a blessing. So I think that would be the right direction.
Yeah. Oh, my daughter's cat's just like an alarm clock in the morning.
Yes.
You talk about your dog, and she does the same thing. She'll come in and get my wife up before she even needs to sometimes. So, oh, well. She's a good alarm clock.
Well, and sometimes people wear buttons and pins and you know, they have shirts with their pets on.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And coffee mugs and mm-hmm. things like that. Tools. Mm-hmm. Tools to keep them close to their heart.
And remembrances too, you know, for mm-hmm. for a pet that may no longer be with you. You mm-hmm. can have a portrait of them, or you can have a, like you say, a button or a shirt. So mm-hmm. it all works.
Yeah. Hey, Joe, you know, you have helped to make this access station here the number one access station. Do you know that?
I've been told that.
That's
recently.
The truth.
Recently.
It gives me great honor and privileged to say that, because I follow in your footsteps.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And it was because you saw the opportunity here. Tell us in a few words, what do you think about this ACPL downtown Fort Wayne, Indiana?
It's just remarkable. I didn't know how I was going to get my message out to a lot of people. And with the help of Access Fort Wayne and my director and all the crew, we're able to put on a quality show that a lot of people are watching now. I'm hearing from a lot of people. And the cable company goes to over 80,000 homes in Allen County, so that's a lot of people that can watch the Paint with Joe show.
That is a lot.
And I didn't know a whole lot about Access Fort Wayne until 2002, but I tell you what, I can't say enough good things about it. I really can't. The folks are great. The equipment's super. The quality of the shows are amazing, the kind of shows that can be put on. And I just couldn't say enough good things about it. Hope it stays here forever.
Hmm. Well, you know, this building here is a temporary building, we're going to go to the new building.
Yeah, and we're going to have three studios.
Yeah.
Oof,
yeah.
That'll be nice.
Yeah. And in talking about the word reflection, the vision for what I'm doing is one world, one dream, mm-hmm. in the spirit of unity. And the library right now is promoting one library, one book. And then mm-hmm. I think of your story. You should really write about your story.
Yeah.
You should write about how your wife suggested to do what you think you can,
not what you can.
Yeah, and sure write a short story, because it's inspiring mm-hmm. to aspire another person with your divine gifts and talents.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we all use those divine gifts and talents.
Oh yeah, got to do that
in our work and our play.
Yeah,
I can't distinguish the two. I'm just having such fun.
Oh yeah, it is. It's just a great time every first and third Monday morning. I just, you know, I get to come down here and do the show. And we do have a live studio audience, as I told you. So
yeah.
If the folks out there would like to come down in the studio with us, they're more than welcome to do that. So.
Well, perhaps I'll come down and I'll learn how to paint one
day. I hope you do. You're always invited.
That would be a fun thing.
Yeah.
What do I have to bring?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing. Just come down. Oh, you mean you actually want to?
Well, yeah.
Well,
I mean, I couldn't keep up to you, but my heavens, I might be able to get at least the undercoat on there or
one
something.
Of the reasons why we run the colors across the screen on the show,
yeah,
that's for people at home that may want to paint along with me.
That's smart, Joe.
And there are people at home that do that. They've called me and told me that, you know, what they have to do is they have to do like I first started doing. They have to pause it and then catch up and then push the play button and then pause it and then catch up. But I know they're doing it, and that's why we run the colors across, so that they know what colors to use on their palette.
That's smart and creative,
yeah,
Joe.
Yeah. Well, I had.
Did that take a long time to plan?
No, actually, I pretty much patterned the show after what Bob Ross did.
Ah.
And that's the way he did it too. So.
Bob Ross. Tell me just a little bit about this guy. I know you talked about him and PBS. Have you met him?
No, I never got the opportunity. Bob passed away in July 4th, 1995.
Oh.
Died of cancer.
Oh.
And that day, the world lost a
Oof.
Wonderful man.
Oof.
We were in our first certification class, and one of his staff instructors, who was one of the first four people with him and knew him for years, asked the whole class. There were 23 of us in class, and they said, "How many of you have ever met Bob Ross?" Of course, nobody raised their hand because nobody had. And they said, how many people have ever watched Bob Ross on TV? And of course, everybody raised their hand. And she said, "Then you've all met Bob Ross." Because that's exactly the way he was in person. The way he was on TV was exactly the way he was in person. So I guess I have met Bob Ross, but not personally, no.
I almost think his spirit's here right now. I feel it.
But
you
I've been able to rub
chill.
Shoulders with those that have known him, though. And that was neat. Neat
yeah.
to just hear them talk about him. But. He was an artist most of his life, as I gather. He lived in Alaska. He was from Muncie, Indiana. That's where WIPB, PBS in Muncie, put the show on. So.
Oh, I didn't
know
that.
Yeah, the show was taped right here in Indiana. And he lived in New Smyrna Beach, Florida, Alaska, and places like that. So.
Well, he left a legacy.
Oh, yeah, he sure did.
For so many.
He's still on PBS stations, over 230
of them. Is he really?
Yeah, clear across the United States. And he did over 400 shows. And if you've never seen him paint before, they're all brand new to you. They're reruns now. They're reruns, but if you've never seen him before, they're brand new. So
I've seen him. You know, it's like you can want to do something, but unless you want to do something, then you're not paying attention, and that's all it really costs you is to pay attention. You know. Yeah. To do and to accomplish.
Yeah, that's what you have to do. You have to give yourself permission first and then go through with it.
Well, I was so glad when I stopped by, when I was walking by here the other day and saw the door cracked open. I said, oh, Joe's in there. I have to stop. Well, you were live. Yeah. And of course, I couldn't talk to you, but I was truly honored to have your phone call and to immediately get together and do this wonderful opportunity, this wonderful world here. I have one last quick question I have to ask you this, Joe, because, you know, we're family now.
Okay.
We're family now. If angels at God Central Station can support you in any way, what would that be?
Well, if just your viewers could watch the show and enjoy it, I think that would be what I really want to impart to people. Just watch the show, enjoy it, and just take whatever you can from it. But always remember, all you have to do is try, and you really can do it. So I invite everyone to try.
Peaceful and honored, Joe, I am so thankful and grateful to be in your presence. Truly a gift. You're an angel. I see all those halos on all this artwork. You are an angel, and I want you to come back, or I'm going to come on your show. I'm going to surprise you someday walking in here.
You're welcome.
You're
always welcome.
Definitely support you in all that you do to inspire.
Well, thanks for having me on your show, too. It's quite a pleasure.
I feel like I'm a celebrity now.
I've never done a talk show before, so this
you
is
You haven't?
First nope. First one.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really neat too. Yeah.
It is.
You enjoyed it.
It's fun. Someday I'd like to meet Lois too.
Okay, maybe. Yeah, we can do that.
Yeah. My middle name's Louise.
Really?
Yeah. That's close to Lois.
Some of the telemarketers call her Louise.
Do they?
Oh well.
That's
we
fun.
Won't go there.
So we have your address.
Okay.
We have your address for your classes out of your home. And we have your...
It's all on the website.
It's all on the website. Mm-hmm. Tell us that number, that website again.
Paintwithjoe.com.
Easy.
Yeah.
Websites are the way to go. I
try to make it easy.
Did you link your website with Access yet?
No, I haven't.
Well...
But I better get that done.
You better get that done. Access and Access. And so now, Joe, it's time to say goodbye.
Okay.
You want to help me say goodbye?
Sure.
It's real easy.
Okay.
The last four words, I'll ask you to join in with me. It goes like this. Thank you all for stopping, looking, and listening to our divine appointment here today on another episode of Calling All Angels Hotline, live at 5. I was here with Paint with Joe, and with this we say, divine love and holy kisses.
Oh, that's pretty. Divine love and holy kisses.
Yeah.
That's pretty.
Yeah. Like your paintings.
Yes.